so we're talking about electric power. We're not discussing the overall energy situation in Iran. We're just discussing electric power. Let's bear that in mind. And in Iran's electric power scene, nuclear is tricky. At the moment, nuclear power provides 1.5% of Iran's generating capacity. And the Iranian government has announced these grand ambitions to build more nuclear power plants that are unlikely to be anywhere near being completed on schedule. But if they were completed on schedule, then the share of nuclear power might conceivably rise to almost 5%, which is not the big picture. In fact, if we were looking at electricity in Iran, what we're talking about is two other fuels, two other principal sources. One of them is hydro, and the other is natural gas. Iran makes extensive use of its hydro capacity. Most of the country is quite dry, so it's not great for hydro. But the north is relatively wet and very mountainous. So Iran gets more than 12% of its electricity from hydro. It's more than the United States. And then all of the rest comes from natural gas. Iran has the world's second largest natural gas reserves and makes extensive use of this natural gas. Iran is one of the countries of the world that uses the highest percentage of natural gas in their energy consumption mix. And in fact, even in surface transport vehicles. Iran has the highest percentage of any country in the world of surface transport vehicles that are powered by compressed natural gas and liquefied natural gas. So there are a lot of issues in the Iranian electricity sector. I could stand up here for some time and explain to you the problems they have of, their plants are not as efficient as they should be. And it would be quite possible for them, by increasing the efficiencies of their plants, to substantially reduce new construction and forego altogether the need for most of the new plants that they're talking about building. I could also talk to you about their excessive consumption of electricity, thanks to their tariff rates to residential consumers are 1/8 the rates in the United States. Tariff rates are too low to cover the cost of generation and distribution. Even if they pay nothing for the fuel, they still don't get the money back. That combined with a very lax regulatory environment with essentially no standards for insulation and for air conditioners and the like, it results in ridiculous uses of electricity. Iran's consumption of primary energy is twice that of its neighbor Turkey, a country of similar terrain, similar population, and much larger GNP. So there are a lot of issues in the electricity sector that I could go into, but I don't think you're here to hear about electricity. I think you're much more interested in the nuclear issues. So let me just touch on a few more points about the nuclear power in Iran. There is at the moment one nuclear power plant, which took forever to build, partly because of the usual delays in nuclear power plants, and partly, frankly, because the Russians slowed down the process. The delays in construction were not because of the kind of environmental concerns that you run into in the United States, but money. The Iranians were very slow to pay the Russians for the construction, and that slowed down the pace many times. Even before the Russians started slow rolling again. The Iranians have signed contracts to the Russians. They signed a firm contract for the construction of two nuclear power plants, one of which is already under construction, and is supposed to be completed in 2024, the second one in 2026. They'd be next to the existing plants. And there is an aspirational contract for two more plants at Bushehr and four more plants that would be Iranian built with Russian assistance. The aspirational deal for these eight power plants specifies that all eight of them would use Russian fuel. Russia would provide all of the fuel, take back all of the fuel, and none of the fuel that Iran is proposing to enrich or is enriching it at Natanz will ever make it into any of the existing power plant or any of the 8 power plants that are being discussed at the moment. So there are no plans for any construction of a plant that would use the Natanz at any time before 2040. That might make you a little bit suspicious about why exactly they're producing fuel now if they're not going to need it until at least 2040. Well, that might suggest to you that the reasons for the Natanz enrichment facility has relatively little to do with electricity and has to do with other things. The Iranians have, in their latest January 28th letter to the IAEA, announced that they're going to start work on naval propulsion. Since the only naval propulsion purposes that use nuclear power are either submarines, which Iran's never built one, or icebreakers, which Iran is not known to need particularly, it's an interesting letter to the IAEA. I'll just close by saying that the story about the nuclear power in Iran has very little to do with electricity. It has something to do with national prestige. Khamenei, Iran's leader, has frequently talked about the importance of having advanced technology in Iran, and he generally casts the question of nuclear power in that framework of advanced technology. And he complains that the West blocks Iran from getting what it should naturally have, and his complaints have been that the West does not want Iran to have advanced industry, and he uses the nuclear power as an example. So that's part of the reason for nuclear power. But I would just suggest that the enrichment facility in Natanz demonstrates that that's not the only reason. That Iran has poured billions of dollars into fuel enrichment activities, which it acknowledges it will not use for more than 50 years after the beginning of the work of those facilities in the early 1990s. It doesn't take a whole lot of imagination to figure out what else that enriched fuel could be used for.